Also, which is Rob Michero of LAC Products, who's going to talk about the wine that is now in our glass, the Trinity Canyon Vineyards. And quickly, Paul will have a wine available in a few months' time, I'm told. Look for it, ask for it. He and his colleague are here to answer your questions about it later on. So, Rob Michero, please.
Thank you.
The floor is yours.
Thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank Dr. McGovern for his comments. And as duly noted and as recorded, there was no carbon dating of tartarics, and as a result of that, the evidence is not 100% conclusive that this is the oldest established viticultural find in the world. However, if you're Armenian, it is. And what I find that the dialogue and the intellectual academic discussions and arguments between physical anthropologists and social anthropologists, of which you brought in, of course, social anthropology and in the archives and the writings, etc. This is paramount to Trinity Canyon, which I did not know specifically 5 years ago. Trinity Canyon is owned primarily by a managing director by the name of Joaquin Sagatian, and he came about because he owns a restaurant, and he owns it in the capital of Armenia, and he loved wines coming from that area. He's not a trained enologist, a viticulturalist, a metamorphologist, or a geologist. But the fact of the matter is, he said, I love wine, and he is a historian, and he's written 3 different books, some on the biblical miracle of Canaan is one that traces beyond that, back about 4,000 years to different archives, and makes an argument that it doesn't make any difference what physical anthropologists say. We know that this existed as Noah's Ark is on the mountain. So you have this interesting sociological, dialectic, historical perspective within the country that exists in Napa Valley in 1860, 70, 80. And if we trace on a commercial level something that Paul talked about, that Alberto talked about, the biggest problem is infrastructure. If we're talking about sanitation, it's infrastructure. If we're talking about transportation, it's infrastructure. And if we realize what this country went through with the domination of the Soviet Union, grapes were ripped out, and if they were there, they were made into brandy. And so anybody who was in the 1920s or 30s or 40s who was fourth or fifth generation, guess what? They're not making wine anymore. And then what happened to 2 generations dialectically evolving from there? They make brandy, they make vodka, or they don't make anything. So that's what I mean by the dialectic. There's a reason for it today. Now, what's happened with Russia's rebirth, and as Lisa talked about in Georgia, there's an infusion of capital because they joined the EU. Okay, and so that's I hope that wasn't too earth-shattering. But so on a commercial level, you know, we have to remember, if we look at the tracing commercially of the vine, look at what the Phoenicians did. That's how grape product and wine, and you talked about it, Doctor, how it ended up in different places. And the Phoenicians were what? They were the modern steamship line, the cultural conduit for the development in social anthropology of transmigration of cultural indices from one culture to another. Well, it's back, but it's still very, very difficult, as you know, Paul, and as Alberto knows, and Zora knows. So having said that, we're in California, and obviously, and we're in our own cultural center of the universe. If we go up to Oregon, it's the same thing. Try to sell Napa Valley in Portland. I mean, you can do it, But you're going to find more Washington State Merlots and Cabernets than you will have about wines. So that plays into the commercialization aspect of this. Anyway, so there's three partners that created...
Not those guys.
The created Trinity. One is this Huckleman, who's very passionate in putting his money where his mouth is and really working. And, by the way, the wine is made exactly where Paul makes his wine, in the very same place as the other. A consulting enologist who has a bachelor's in biology from Montpellier, in addition to a master's in viticulture and enology from Guggenheim University in Germany, in addition to viticulture from Montpellier. The influence in Lebanon that you will see, you'll see Syrah, you'll see Cinsault, you'll see Rhone varietals, you will see Cabernet and Merlot. The classic, quote, varietals, and most of the wineries do that. It's commercial. On the other side, as in Trinity Canyon, being less than 2 kilometers from the Areni Cave, they are experimenting with two varietals, indigenous, which I'm assuming you meant native. I'm not sure what native meant, Doctor. We can talk about that more. The Areni grape, the Areni Noir, which you have in front of you. It's evolving. It is trial and error. This is a laboratory. It isn't UC Davis. This is pre-UC Davis. Think about the wine business in California, pre-UC Davis. The fact is, Dr. Emery, the wine business, to most people, including Robert Mondavi, will say, it started in 1946. That's when it really started, because that's when we can really trace the metamorphology, the microclimatic uniqueness, in addition to the science of viticulture, and as amplified by vinification. They have a long way to go, but people like Paul Hobbs and these gentlemen are making a difference. It's a tiny industry. When you consider that the total GNP last year of Armenia was $15 billion. $15 billion was the total GNP. How much was agriculture of that total number? 20%. Of the 20%, how much was viticulture? 2%. I mean, you gotta eat before you drink, although I disagree with that. So let's put it as a reality on the basis. They are producer driven and they are market driven. The majority of the wines that made in Armenia are not made. They're going to end up in your restaurant or yours. They're Verdi. They're sweet varietals. Many of them are fortified. Why are they sweet? Because they haven't, in the last 20 years, been able to develop dry varietal fermentations that are clean. Go back to California in 1910. What was it? Vitis Concordia, Vitis Rotundia, and Vitis Vinifera. But the majority of wine that was consumed was sweet, amplified, and fortified wine. Same thing is true. So they're moving right along. In regard to this wine, it is 100% Ani, if you speak Armenian, or if you're from Texas, Arani, Noir. Okay? And the fact of the matter is, this is the third vintage of this. The winery's only, you know, developed 7 years. Experimentation. There's approximately 4.5 hectares at the moment. There's another 3 hectares to be developed. It is 50% planted, the head pruned, ancient style, varietal, Vitis vinifera. And the other is a double cordon that you'll see in the Rhone and all over France and in Napa Valley. Not in dry creek for Zinfandel, not Italian. What you get is really great extraction. It's more modern. And yet, the acidities, which are always the dilemma, it's old world. I found the second wine that we had, the tannins were hard, right? Harder than what we get out of Sonoma. Harder than what the current trend is. The alcohols are more balanced. They tend to be 12 to 13%. Not what we're doing in California today at 14 or 15 for different reasons. They tend to be a little leaner and structured, and they tend to be more European, quote, French in style. On the whole. Zora's wine, unbelievable. You tasted it. The extraction is greater than this. I don't know what the PSI is when you're pressing out. You know, winemakers from California will talk, oh, I'm 2 tons to the acre, 5 tons to the acre, but no one talks about what the press rate is. Let's talk about Burgundy. What's the premier going through? 285 gallons to 300 gallons to the acre. That's the real number you want to look at. Because of trial and error, right, Paul? You might be below that. And it's not because of design, it's because of the necessity at the time of that vintage and that harvest. 1,500 total cases comes out of Trinity Canyon. The potential is about 3,500. So you're talking about the boutique guy who's working very hard to develop a producer-driven mentality wine, which you're beginning to see. But guess what producer mentality wines are? They're money. Big money. It takes us 8 to 10 to 12 weeks to get a container from Lebanon, number one. Number two, the producers don't cooperate and they don't want to share containers. So go back to what California was in the 20s. Do you think little Italian Giuseppe in the Dry Creek area was talking to his cousin 4 miles away saying, tell me what you're doing in this fermentation? They don't cooperate. And that's because they're working so hard, idiosyncratically, to develop their own nature and learn as science. Until it's developed, there won't be cooperation because there's nothing to cooperate on per se. And so dialectically, that's where this area is. Who are the winemakers? Yes, you do have a few Armenians. The majority of winemakers are worldwide winemakers coming from a traditional Davis or Montpellier or wherever in the world. And the ownership isn't necessarily Armenian, but on the whole it is. That will change and evolve as the flavor components, the organoleptics, develop. Because the majority of Armenians drink sweet wine. They don't drink white wine, a dry wine. So that's the culture. And from my standpoint, I think you've had enough of me, but thank you very much. You guys have any questions?